Good morning. My name is Mark Daniel. I'm the Alamance County Extension Director and Horticulture Agent. This morning we're going to talk about vegetable gardening. It's almost springtime and people start to get excited to talk about gardening. And so there are different reasons why people garden. So it's just good exercise, relaxation, and that's really what it is for me. Most of the people I work with think I'm kind of strange because I don't eat many summer vegetables. I don't like tomatoes. I don't like peppers. I don't really like squash. I don't really like those things at all, but I like to grow them. And so they do enjoy the fact that I'll grow a lot of tomatoes and then I give them away, and people like that very much. Yeah. Unfortunately, my wife moved and I went with her, and our new house has no space for garden. We have too much shade. So I'm not in tomato business this year. I've got to find another place to garden because I have no garden area now, but I just do it. Oh, okay. That might work. So there's lots of things up there, different reasons that people have for growing a garden, and everybody's kind of different. So, fresh vegetables is a pretty wonderful thing to have. So as you're starting to think about gardening, and this is where some people get into trouble, and I look around the county every year, and this time of year people are starting to plant their gardens, all excited, and then June rolls around and it starts to get kind of hot and the grass comes along and people get discouraged because it ends up being a lot of work. So the perception is, garden of this happy young couple there, and everything is wonderful, but the reality of gardening is more like this. It's going to be hot and dirty and sweaty kind of work, but if you enjoy doing it like I do, then that's all worthwhile, even if you don't eat much that you grow. So this is the way that my grandparents gardened. They lived on a farm, and so it was just as easy to plant a 300-foot long row of collards as it was a 20-foot row. And that's what they did, but nobody really has that kind of space or really that kind of time to garden like that anymore. So we're trying to garden into smaller areas. So this is a garden we've had around our flagpole out front. That picture was taken, Chris, 5 or 6 years ago?
Yeah.
Probably. That's changed now, so the knockout rows are gone, and we've put in some raised beds. I make it a little bit easier so I can get down pretty good and work in the garden. I have a little trouble getting back up anymore. So the raised beds are a whole lot better for me because I can bend over and get to things without having to get down on the ground. So really the garden looked pretty nice, and it was very productive in a small space if you know what you're doing and use the right kind of technique. So we had here, this was probably was about 40 pounds of lettuce that we carried to the Allied Church's shelter, or just from, there's two little patches right here. So you can grow a lot of food in a fairly small space if you do everything right. So had a lot of good stuff there, good broccoli. I do like broccoli, so the cool season stuff is what I like, not so much the summer stuff, but had nice broccoli, lettuce, did a real good job. So the thing to think about is site selection. So really the first thing is sunlight. If you don't have sunlight, you might as well forget it. You've got to have that. You can sort of change your soil and you can work on watering systems, but you have to have sunlight if you're going to have a garden, especially with the summer stuff, the fruiting stuff. So the leafy stuff you can get by with a little bit of shade, but the fruiting vegetables, you've just got to have full sun in order to do a good job. So a minimum of 6 hours, that's for the leafy vegetables. But it's going to be more like 8 or 10 hours as you're getting in tomatoes and peppers and squash. Okay, so that's just a little list there. So potatoes are probably the most shade tolerant, fruiting vegetables being the least. Okay, so really, and you talk about the garden, you want to have it close to the house and you want to have it close to a water source. So I find that people have a garden somewhere else. So that's the problem with me having a garden at your house, is that it's just not convenient. And would I come to your house every day to work on the garden?
No.
Probably not. If it's in my backyard, then it's more convenient. I'm more likely to go out there and tend to it than I would if it's somewhere away. If you don't tend to it on a regular basis, you will have trouble. And you want to start small. So this, it's about 1,000 square feet, which actually is pretty big. This room is about 1,000 square feet. That's a pretty good sized garden. And they talk about a half an hour a day, and that might be true, but that's a half an hour every day. So if you go off to the beach for a week or it rains 2 or 3 days, the grass will get ahead of you really, really quick. So I'd start pretty small, certainly much smaller than that, and then work your way up as you get more confident in what you're doing. You can increase the size of your garden. Okay, so you want to think about what you want to grow, and you want to plan. And this is where people sometimes fall down. They don't plan very well what they want to grow. They just buy plants and go out there and put them in the ground and end up with too much of something and not enough of something else. So you really want to think about the plan and our planting dates. We are lucky here. We can garden 12 months out of the year. So we have some cold weather, but it usually is not so much that we can't take some things through the wintertime. We'll talk about row covers in a little bit. That can be helpful. So you got to think about how you're going to plant and when you're going to plant, and successive planting is a way to go. So several years ago, and I like broccoli very much, and so one year I planted, is at least, I don't know, 60 or 70 broccoli plants all at the same time. But I like broccoli a lot, not thinking that it all matures in the same week or two. And that's a lot of broccoli. So I froze some and I gave some away, but then I learned quickly that what I need to do is plant some and wait a couple weeks and plant some more. So I plant a couple dozen at a time instead of 5 dozen at a time, where you can handle the harvest a whole lot better. So we do have some crops that mature fairly quickly, and you can plant those a little bit more often, and the longer season crops, you would spread those out a little bit more to make sure that you don't get too much of one thing at any one time where you really can't handle it. Unless you're really good at canning or freezing, you can end up with too much stuff. And of course, that's okay if your neighbors like to have it and you pass it on to them or your relatives, and that can work too. Okay, so you should have one of these handouts here. So this is a planting guide for the springtime. It tells you what to plant and when. And so there's things here now. So they're talking about snap beans, pole beans, April the 15th. So we're coming pretty close to the time to start planting some of these things. I have seen tomato plants at the stores. I actually saw tomato plants at one of the box stores on March the 1st. And if you don't know, March the 1st is too early to plant tomato plants. We still are likely, maybe. Record lows now are still in the mid-20s, so average last frost date is about April 20th or so. So we can still have some cold weather. I think Sunday morning's going down to 32. So you could plant tomatoes now, but you better cover them. Yes, ma'am.
If you're planting on the balcony, can you plant a little bit earlier than?
You probably could if you have some way to cover the plants, right? And especially if you're just doing 2 or 3. So I wouldn't go out and plant 2 dozen. But if you plant 2 or 3, you could take the chance on them getting hurt and you can replace those pretty easily. Yes, ma'am.
Is the ground warm enough now? The earth warm enough?
Yes.
To put the things in there?
Yep. Yeah. For I'd say for the beans, they probably are. So we're probably up.
Not for tomatoes.
No, well, we're probably, soil temperature now is probably between 55 and 60, which is pretty close. So crabgrass has already germinated a couple weeks ago, but it has to be semi-warm, so it's getting close to that time. Okay. But we still have a chance of frost.
Yeah, they said we'd get frost this weekend.
Good, we could very well. So that's a good chart there. However, it's a little bit harder for me to visualize what I want to plant. So this is another one here. This is a white quarls planting guide. You don't have that, but you can get this at places like Farm Services, Grain Feed and Seed, Med and Shrubbery. The advantage in this is it has an extra column, so it tells you the distance between rows. So the other one tells you distance between plants, but this gives you distance between rows, so that's a nice chart to have too. But what I really like is this one that Chris did for me. She made this spreadsheet, so as I'm trying to look through the list of plants, and you should have a copy of this, but I can tell what I can plant and when. So with the other sheets, you had to kind of go through there and highlight what you'd plant in the springtime. But this one, I can just look at that real quick and say, okay, so it's May 1st. I got probably a dozen different things that I can plant in May. And so then I can decide, okay, well, what do I want to plant? How much do I want to plant? And where it becomes more complicated is these seasons overlap. And so you'll see that a lot of our fall cool season crops start coming in here July and August. Well, probably your tomatoes are probably still doing, hopefully still doing pretty good the 1st of August. Well, it's time to start pulling something out to plant your broccoli. And that's always a discussion at our house. My wife likes tomatoes and I don't. And I really like broccoli and cabbage and collards and all the fall stuff. So we have to have a discussion about how many tomatoes can I pull up in order to start planting the fall stuff. So if you wait too late, if you wait over until, say, the middle of September, you probably can do okay with lettuce and spinach, things like that. But broccoli, cauliflower, cabbage, things that have to make a head, they may not make a head before cold weather comes. They won't die, but they won't make a head if you wait too long to plant them. So you've got to get those in early. So you've got to decide, do I leave some space? If you plant, Irish potatoes, back in March, they won't mature until probably the end of June. Well, then that pushes your tomatoes further over. So you've got to think about how much space do you want. You don't want to plant the whole garden in potatoes, because then something's going to have to not be planted. So this is a real good chart that Chris made there. So you can kind of look at what you can plant when and realize there are overlapping seasons, so you can't fill the garden completely. Yes, ma'am.
I planted beets and lettuce and snow peas in February. Does that mean that when it snows, I don't have to run out and cover them over? I mean, we've had four snows since then.
Yeah, that they're fine, except,
okay?
Right, except for, and if it goes down to mid-low 20s, you might want to cover them.
Oh, okay.
Some.
Because okay, I've been babying them.
Yeah, not necessary.
Oh.
Yeah, they're pretty hard.
That was nice. Thank
you. They're still growing.
Yeah. And so one of the things that I like to do is try different things. You want to experiment and try a different variety or something you haven't grown before. I've tried to grow eggplant and never successful because of the flea beetles. But you just try different things. Some things work well, some things don't work well. But experimenting is part of the fun. So green beans are something that I like very much. But like I said, bush beans are one of those things that it's hard to pick. I can't bend over real well, and while I can get down good, getting back up is hard. And so I have done pole beans, and pole beans are a little bit easier because they're growing up high and you can pick those pretty good. So this is my pole bean experiment here. So I had this little space beside the fence. I thought, well, that'd be a good place to till up and plant some pole beans there. And so I planted my beans that came up pretty well. And then I built a trellis. So I got this trellis material from Johnny Seed Company. I cut some bamboo from one of our master gardeners' yards. And so this thing is 10 feet high. So it's a very nice trellis. I was very proud of my trellis. And the beans grew very well on the trellis. So that's my pole beans. Okay, again, that's 10 foot high. So how do you pick beans off a 10 foot high trellis? Well, you can use a ladder. This row is 80 feet long, and so that's a lot of going up and down the ladder to pick your pole beans. Okay. Well, is there a better way to do it? Maybe. So I thought, well, I'll do this. We just drive the truck along the side of the row, and I can either stand on top of the toolbox or stand in the bed and pick the beans. And that worked pretty good, better than climbing up and down the ladder. But you got to have a driver to do that. And at that time, this had been, maybe 8 years ago. Our daughter was about 15. She's learning how to drive. She was learning how to drive. And she didn't really have good coordination between the brake and the gas pedal so much. And she threw me out a couple of times. And I decided maybe that wasn't the very best way to do that. So I never did pull beans like that again. But I tried. It seemed like a good idea. It grew very well. The harvesting part was where we sort of fell down with that. Okay. On one of your sheets, you should have a crop rotation thing here. We won't spend much time on crop rotation, but just to know that if you grow your tomatoes in the same spot year after year after year, and you're growing something like a German Johnson tomato, which is a good tomato according to most people, you're going to have disease problems. Being an heirloom, it has no disease resistance, and you'll have some soil-borne diseases, and you'll start to have a problem with the German Johnson tomato. So you want to rotate to a different place in the garden just to try and break that disease cycle. So a pretty simple crop rotation. We have some of our organic farmers that have a 10-year crop rotation. So really intensive, and it takes a lot of time to set that up. But this is just a 4-year rotation. That works very well. Okay. So we're talking about intensive gardens. We're trying to get a lot of stuff in a small space. We don't want to have a huge garden with a lot of wasted space. So we're trying to get a lot of stuff together there. Soil preparation is going to be the key. We have some fairly poor soil in some places. And you've got to get that soil in good condition in order to be productive. And we want to plan very carefully about what we're going to put where and how this is all going to work for us. Yes, ma'am.
Question.
Sure.
My son-in-law wants me to grow a garden. Well, I moved here from Asheville, so I don't even know what zone we're in right now.
Seven.
Thank you. And he looked up this Hugel culture, which is this. Okay, well.
Hey, never heard of that.
Apparently, you dig a hole 2 feet deep.
Okay.
He can do that. He's got equipment. You put logs in it, then you put branches on it. Then you put whatever turf grass you dug up upside down on it, and then you throw a whole lot of dirt on top.
Okay.
And it's a German thing, and it's supposed to last at least 10 years, and you it's like it could be 4 to 6 feet tall, and you plant in it, but you never heard of it. It's supposed to conserve water, and as the stuff breaks down underneath, you know, it's supposed to give the plants some nutrition.
Okay.
Has anybody ever heard of it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think?
It's online.
Yeah,
I started looking it up a little bit.
On
it's
YouTube.
Yeah. It's possible, but well, the reason I'm asking about that is that the land they have, it's hard to get water to. And I lived through last summer here, and it was hot as Hades, and I couldn't believe it, how hot it was. And I was a little worried about the water situation. And it says that if you put like a swale in front of it, it collects water, and it's supposed to be.
Yeah. It'll collect water if it rains.
Yeah.
Right.
If
it rains.
If it doesn't rain, which happens here more often.
Right.
I'm a little dubious.
Okay, well,
let us know how it works.
Yeah. I'm afraid to try it.
Yeah, I'm not sure that it's worth the effort. I can't see how. Yeah, I can't see how. As you raise things up, then the water is going to drain out faster.
Yeah.
So that's the idea behind raised bed gardening that drains out the soil, drift the water. So that.
I don't know. They're building it in deserts.
Yeah.
I don't. Okay.
I'm skeptical.
Experiment.
Yeah. Yes. It would be that. I wouldn't do everything like that, though.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is. How I garden says these are 3-foot beds. So I got a bed that's 3 foot wide here, and then I have an aisle that's 3 foot wide, but I'm planting right on the edge of the 3-foot bed. So as the plants grow, my aisle ends up being maybe 12 inches or so. And so I get to do like 4 rows of cabbage, 3 rows of broccoli, 2 rows of tomatoes, 3 rows of beans, but really trying to pack the stuff in there as best I can. That also helps control the weeds. So if there isn't much space between the plants, the weeds are shaded out, so you don't really have much of a weed problem there. So you're just trying to get as much stuff as you can in a small area as you possibly can. Okay. So we're going to have to deal with our soil. You've got to work with what you got to work with. And so adding organic matter and building raised beds will be probably the thing that we have to do in order to be successful. So there are all kinds of raised beds there. We did find that building raised beds is pretty expensive. So a lot of these materials, whether it's treated lumber or masonry or whatever it is, are very expensive to build these things, but you may have to do that if you just have terrible soil. You could just use a simple raised bed like this, so if you have enough space, adding organic matter and mounding it up, you get better drainage and aeration. You can be very successful doing this without having to have the expense of actually building some kind of structure.
Excuse me, in that one, it looked like they had put something in the rows to prevent leaks.
Which one? Here?
Yeah.
Those are probably leaves. Yeah, I think there's probably cardboard newspaper under it and some leaves on top to keep it from blowing away. That works very well. Okay, so we talk about soil preparation. So soil testing is something we always recommend, so you don't have to guess at, you know, how much lime, how much fertilizer that you need to have, and then added organic material to increase the quality of the soil. So we're talking about soil here. So, and here is our typical Alamance County topsoil. And this really is not that bad. So we have white and yellow clays that are terrible. You can work with this if you do it right, and the trick is to add some organic matter, whether it's a pine bark or a leaf compost, either one of those work fine, and you can end up with a soil that's loose and that you can work by hand versus, you know, having to have some tool and kill yourself doing it. You can still use this to make a little hole, but you don't have to beat it to death. You can mix these two together and really make a good soil out of this red clay. Okay, Chris. All right. So we don't want to guess about the soil test. I'll tell you a real quick story. So I thought several years ago it was a good idea for me to go to church with my doctor. I figured that way, if I have some little something, you know, I can catch him at the church and ask him the question, don't have to pay, or don't have to go to Cronoto Clinic and wait for 2 hours to see him. But one time after church, I see my wife and my doctor talking, and they're kind of across the room there, and they talk a little bit, and they turn and look at me. And they talk some more, and they turn and look at me. I'm like, I don't think this is good. So I go over there, and of course, they're talking about me, and I've gained some weight over the past few years, and, you know, you got cholesterol and high blood pressure and all this kind of stuff. And I said, well, yeah, that's maybe true. I said, but, you know, if times get hard and there's a shortage of food, I've stocked up. I'm good for a couple weeks probably. If I can find some water to drink, I'm good to go. And I said, and my doctor's one of these kind of skinny jogging guys, and I said, he's not going to make it. You know, he's good for a day or two, but he has no reserve like I do. He put me on cholesterol medicine because he didn't think it was that funny. But I thought it was. It's a good story to me. Okay, so that's a soil pork trout. We won't spend much time on this, just to say that it will tell you what you need to add, and I can help you interpret these numbers. So it's pretty easy to figure out, rather than guessing, what you need to add to your soil in order to make the plants grow the best that they can. It's going to give you a lime recommendation, fertilizer recommendation, and sometimes they'll give you some numbers that don't make sense, but I can help you with those. That's what I forgot to put up, Chris, with my soil sample boxes. I knew I'd forget something, but we have those here if you're interested in getting the soil test done. Okay, so pH, one thing that the soil test will tell you. And so you can sort of see here in this little window, there are things between pH of 6 and 6.5. That's where most of our nutrients are most available. As you get too high or too low, we run into some deficiencies and some toxicity. So we're trying to shoot for that window between 6 and 6.5, where our plants will grow the best. Okay, so We'll talk about some different products here, and I know everybody, when you go to the grocery store, everybody's looking at the label on the package. Whatever you're going to buy, you want to know calories or sodium or whatever it is. Everybody reads the label. Nobody reads the label when they go to the garden store to buy lime and fertilizer. You just buy whatever has a nice looking package. So this is fast acting lime. That sounds like that'd be a great thing. But it's not cheap. But you need to look at the label, and it talks about this is equal to 5 bags of typical lime. Now, that's a pretty strong statement right there. When you look at the label and you get down to the bottom, let's see here. Here it is. It is hard for you to read. It takes 2,000 pounds of this to equal 1 ton of standard lime. That's about the same the way I figure it. So that's a little misleading. It's not equal to 5 bags of regular lime. It's the same. If it takes 2,000 pounds of this, a ton is 2,000 pounds. Is that right, Ruby? Yeah. So that's a little bit misleading there to say that. And I've had people who had trouble using this on their yards. And they're saying, well, my grass didn't grow and I've been using this fast-acting lime. It's supposed to be good as 5 bags. And their pH is like 5. It's not. Need 5 bags instead of 1. And it's not cheap. So it's $15 for 30 pounds, and you can buy regular lime for probably $4 a bag. It'd be the same. Okay, so pelletized lime, there you go, $4 a bag. This only takes 1,800 pounds of this, so that's actually a little bit better and much cheaper there. So read the label. It does make a difference. And then you get the regular pulverized lime, 1,844 pounds, 350, that's better. So, questions about lime? So read the label, make sure you know what you're buying. Don't be caught by the hype of some of this advertising. So you need to be familiar with the fertilizer analysis. So as you're buying fertilizer, you should know that 10, 10, 10, those numbers represent the percentage of these nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. It could be 10, 10, 10, it could be 10, 20, 20, it could be triple 17. You'll see 50 different fertilizer ratios out there. A lot of this, again, is just kind of a marketing ploy to make you buy something you don't need. But as long as you know that that's what these ratios stand for, then you can make an intelligent decision. So I've got two products here. You got a tomato, vegetable, plant food, flower, evergreen, tree and shrub thing. Does it matter? Can you put the tree and shrub fertilizer on tomatoes? Can you put tomato fertilizer on azaleas? Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter at all. Those names mean nothing. The only thing you're concerned about is the analysis. Pardon?
They're about the same.
Yeah. So it doesn't really matter. So you can put, you know, tomato fertilizer on the holly, it's not going to grow a tomato. You want to be concerned about the analysis and not the picture and the name on the fertilizer. It doesn't matter. Yes, ma'am.
The 10-10-10 is pretty standard
right.
For everything.
Pretty much.
Your yard, your vegetables, your
pretty
flowers.
Pretty much. There are occasions when if you've used a 10-10-10 fertilizer for several years, you may get to the point where you have adequate phosphorus and potassium and only need nitrogen.
So you need to do the analysis.
Right. And that's pretty common. And of course, if you only need nitrogen, then that is a much cheaper product than a complete fertilizer. You've seen these products at the store here, Holly Tone, Tomato Tone. They have probably 12 different tone fertilizers. There's Garden Tone, Bulb Tone, Tree Tone. I don't know. At least 12 of these things out there. And I see people buying tomatoes and buy Tomato Tone. Okay. Well, again, you want to look at the label and see what they tell you. So that's the label. So it's a 4-3-4, 3-4-6. That's virtually the same analysis of the fertilizer. You can look at what it's derived from, so the ingredients are there. It's the same. I would submit it's the very same product. with them.
Acid versus non-acid.
Okay. So the acid part is going to be the sulfur. So our holly tone is 2% sulfur. Tomato tone is 3%. Actually, the tomato tone is a more acid fertilizer than holly tone is.
Okay.
So people buy a holly tone thinking that they need a more acidic fertilizer. It's actually is less than tomato tone. Yes, ma'am.
Mark, I've been told and read online that crushed eggshells for the calcium is good for your tomatoes. Is that true?
Yes, it is.
Good. I've been saving
them. Yep. Now, the only issue with that is that it breaks down very, very slowly.
Well, I got them to a fine powder.
Yep.
I've worked hard on them.
Yep. Perfect. I'd go ahead and get it out there and try and get it incorporated into the soil.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Yep. Well, yes, it is. So what I say is, so it's virtually the same. So if you want to buy holly tone or tomato tone, it's fine. But just buy one, and you use it on everything you got. You don't need to buy holly tone, tomato tone, garden tone, bulb tone. It's all the same. Yes, ma'am.
Can you use Epsom salts for the magnesium?
You can, but you got to be careful.
That's
magnesium sulfate, I think. So you could end up with a pH problem with too much sulfur.
Oh.
So, but yes, I think there is, at a certain level, beneficial. Okay. So virtually the same thing there. So buy one or the other. You don't need to buy every tone that they've got out there. Okay, that's a soil sample I was going to show you. So here, that recommendation is showing you that our phosphorus and potassium is adequate there, so you only need nitrogen. So that is very common in situations where you have used a complete fertilizer for several years. Okay. So there's some straight nitrogen sources there. You can either use conventional or organic sources. Either is fine. The only thing to remember about using like a feather mill product is you need to get that on probably 30 days in advance. It takes a while for that to break down for the plants to take it up. So feather mill works great, but you have to just think ahead. Okay. All right, we'll talk about soil then. Again, amending the soil, we've talked about that. Adding organic matter is going to make that a whole lot better. Want to make sure it's a very well decomposed product versus a raw wood product. So fresh stump grindings or tree chippings need to be composted before you can use those. Manures there, just so you know, there are persistent herbicides that are used on pastures and hayland now. So if you're trying to get manure from Farmer Brown, you need to know where the hay that he's feeding his cows comes from. Because people have gotten in trouble from using animal manure, animals that grazed on this pasture that had these persistent herbicides in them. So you just need to know the source. Now, something like a black cow or Daddy Pete's is fine.
Black cow's okay.
It's fine. So that's gone through a manufacturing process, and it won't be a problem with those. But straight off the farm, you have to be a little bit careful because you can run into a problem, possibly. Okay, then you want to add a 3 or 6 inch layer of this stuff and till it in, and as long as it's fairly well decomposed, then you should be good to go. Okay, so I had a question about leaves, so I can show you the difference between using leaves and not using leaves. So this is my backyard, was my backyard garden. So I got some leaves, but I only had enough to cover half. The area that was covered, I had no weeds. So this was put out in the fall, and so then the section that was not covered, chickweed and henbit and everything there. So yeah, leaves are your friend, not only to incorporate into the soil, but to use as a mulch between rows or during the winter time when the garden's fallow. Makes a huge difference in controlling some of these winter and summer annual weeds. Okay, so here's the process there. So you've got the beds laid out there. Where I'm adding in pine bark fines. I'm going to till that stuff in. And then so there's the garden. So if you prepare the soil well, you can have a good garden. I've got everything pretty well laid out best I could. I've got drip irrigation in there. So you can do real well in a fairly small area. Does take some time. Real quick on tomatoes there. So this is the way that I stake tomatoes. So I got the bamboo poles there where I can put a bamboo pole every two plants, and then I'm using this nylon twine. You can sort of see the twine there in a better picture. There you go. It's on peppers. And basically, you're just taking the twine and just going from pole to pole, just holding the plants together, because I'm growing these are indeterminate tomatoes, which will be 10 foot tall, and that's a good way to hold them up without having to use a cage or tie up individual stems.
That's me. How do you put your
pots
in?
Drive them. So at one time I had a big drill, and I would drill holes out, but that was a little tedious, so I've got like a post driver that you drive like a T-post with, and get up on a ladder and drive them in. Works very well.
How do you keep the pests off when you, or how do you treat them when they're planted that close together for pests?
Yeah, you still can spray them. There's enough room to get in there and still spray them. Yeah. Okay, that's peppers. All right, so we'll talk about seed then. So we want to make sure that you buy a seed that's packaged for the current year. It's probably okay if you found some 2017 seed. It probably is still going to be okay, but the germination is going to go down. So instead of being 90%, maybe 85%, and that's okay. You want to make sure the soil's moist and it stays moist, because once the seed starts germinating, you don't want to let it dry out there. And you want to make sure that you don't plant it too deep, and that could be a real problem there. So there are hybrid seeds, and I recommend using those whenever you can, because they are going to have better performance, better disease resistance. There are some open pollinated things that work very well, some of the beans and tomatoes, but you can run into some disease problems with those older varieties. So it talks about the soil temperature for planting the seeds. So we're probably pretty close to 60 now. As you're looking at tomatoes to buy, you look down here at the bottom and you got the F is for fusarium, V is for verticillium, tomato spotted wilt virus, nematodes, tobacco mosaic virus. So these are all resistance features that you can find in tomatoes, and certainly it's a good idea to try and get a tomato that has some resistance versus one like a German Johnson that has none. Now, if you'd like German Johnson and are willing to put up with problems, then that's fine to do that too. Okay, here's some seed sources. Here, I like the White Quarrel seed. It's a local company, and the seed varieties they sell do very well around here. I buy a lot of seed from Johnny's Seed Company while they're up in New England somewhere. They've got good seed. I like Johnny's has got a really has better spinach. Now, White Quarrel spinach is the Savoy kind. It's got a curly leaf and it's hard to wash it clean. Johnny's has got a smooth leaf spinach, raccoon or space, something I can't remember. But it's easier to clean and very tasty. Okay. Before I get on past my seeds, I was going to show you. So you can just dig a furrow with your hoe and get your bean seed and drop it into the furrow. But I always have trouble with beans and corn, some of this big seeded stuff. You drop it in the furrow and it always bounces out. And then it's not in the row and you got to pick it back up. So for a while, I had a piece of PVC pipe that I could hold down there and drop my seed through there, and it would sort of stay in the furrow pretty good. That's okay. It's a little tedious though. But then I got smarter and I got a seeder. So this is a very nice machine here, and it has different seed plates. So if you're planting sweet corn or early June peas, this is cabbage, turnips, lettuce, you can change these seed plates, and then you just push this down the row, and it has this little piece here that opens the furrow. The seed drops down. The spacing is correct because of the seed plate. It covers over this little chain. I mean, this is a really nice thing. Now, granted, it was probably about $100, but I've had this for 6 or 8 years. You use it for like 30 minutes or an hour, and you put it back in the shed, and you keep this thing forever. So I felt like this. What's that? No doubt. Yes, it's aluminum, so it won't rust. Tommy, so it's, in my mind, that it was a good investment to have a tool which makes planting so much easier and faster, and especially with the small seeded stuff. So have you ever seen turnip seed? Turnip seed is like dust. And so you look at the recommendation, and it's like an ounce for an acre or something. And so if you're planting a small patch, and what you've got is just nothing. And you try and spread that, it's hard to spread. And then you end up, what I've done, well, that's not enough, and put down more. I mean, that's too thick. And then, of course, go to thin it. Now, I'm not doing that. With this, I can go ahead, I can plant this in rows. And so you don't have to worry about thinning it so much, and the space is a whole lot better by using that. So that's the way to go. Okay, thank you, Chris. Okay, irrigation. We'll talk about irrigation. So you're going to have water. If you think that rain is going to do it, you're wrong. It's not. We're going to get in July and August, and it's just not going to rain. And it could be 2-3 weeks. I don't know how long it can be. But it's just not going to rain. And you've got to have water out there to do it. They're talking about an inch of water per week, but that's going to depend. As we get into July and it's 97 degrees and the wind blows and these plants have got some size on them, you may have to water 2 inches a week. And if you don't do it, your plants just will not grow. So that takes 625 gallons to put an inch of water on a 1,000-square-foot garden. And we want to make sure when we do water, we water thoroughly. So going out there and just squirting them a little bit just doesn't help. If you're going to water them, water. So we're going to talk about drip irrigation. I put some catalogs over there. This is a Berry Hill irrigation. I don't work for them, but they're close and they have good irrigation supplies. So if you're interested in drip irrigation, they've got some catalogs back there that they sent me. We bought our irrigation system here from them, and most of our farmers will buy from Berry Hill. So it's a good reputable company, and you can get kits there that will do very well with that. So there's a drip irrigation system here. You've got a connection to the water hose. You've got a filter, pressure reducer, and this is kind of the main line. And then you've got individual rows. This is a what they call a lay flat tubing, and so there are emitters in that tubing every 12 inches. So it doesn't really matter when you lay the tape out where it is in relationship to the plants, because it's going to wet a pretty good size area after you run it for an hour or so. And I've got a sample right here. So this end hooks up to the garden hose from the house. You've got a filter here, so even coming off the house, you could have some trash that got in the garden hose or whatever, and you don't want to clog up your emitters. And then you've got a pressure reducer here, because all of these fittings are, compression fittings. So that nothing's glued together here. The tape comes off, you just roll this wheel back out and it comes back on. So if you're trying to use household pressure, you'll blow it apart. So you have to have a pressure reducer here. So this then would fit on the end of this hose, and then there you go. And then you've got the lay flat tape here going out to the individual rows of plants. You've got a connector here that has a valve on it, and I like to use the valve connectors. So if I have a row that's empty, then I can just turn that off. They also have connectors that don't have a valve. They're right much cheaper, but you don't have the opportunity to turn this row off. You just have to run it all the time. So it's a simple system, doesn't require any tools really to put it together, and very, very efficient way to water the garden. Questions about drip? One. One thing I'll tell you is that if you're running that and you need to add fertilizer, you can run, they have a injector. You can run a liquid fertilizer through this injector through the drip system if you wanted to. That works pretty well too. All right. And the nice thing about this is the kind of thing that rather than having to stand out there with the garden hose and just hold it, which is boring, you could turn this on and just let it run. So I come home after work, turn it on, go out and make sure I don't have a leak, because sometimes a mouse will come out there and bite a hole in the tape, and then you've got a little geyser. You can fix that pretty quickly. Turn it on, make sure everything's working well. Go inside, have dinner, you know, sit in the chair, read the paper, let it run a couple of hours, go back outside, turn it off, and you're good to go. And it just makes watering so much easier than trying to hold a hose out there. It also helps with disease problems. So if you're using some kind of a sprinkler system, you get the tomato leaves wet, that's going to create problems with disease too.
Are you saying you do that most every day if you do
no,
the rain?
No, once a week.
Once a week. Okay.
And sometimes it'll be twice a week as we get into the end of July, first part of August. If it's getting really, really hot, I may go twice a week. For the most part, you probably can get by with a good soaking once a week. Okay. Pest management, this is something that is a problem for everybody. If you have a garden, the pests are going to come. You just know that's going to happen. So we talk about trying to get plants that maybe have some resistance. We want to get out there and scout. So that's one thing about having the garden close to the house. You can get out there on a daily basis and just walk around and just look and see what you see. So if you find a couple little bugs, you can take care of it. If you wait a week, a small problem can be a big problem really, really quick. So you want to be on top of it and make sure that you don't let these things get ahead of you. Cultural practices, so don't get the tomato leaves wet. Just making sure you're trying to do things that keep the plants healthy. You'll have less problems. Then know the pest. So you don't have to be an entomologist. So if you get some kind of insect out there in your garden, you're not sure what it is, you can bring it in and Chris can identify it for you. She's a whiz at pest ID. So you just need to know that really only 3% of the insects you see are going to be a problem. Most of the insects out there are either beneficial or harmless. They just could be just traveling by and just land on your tomato plant, but they're not doing any damage, there's no harm. You don't need to worry about them. Biological control, so there are things like BT products, bacteria, works very well for a lot of our caterpillars, very, very safe. Mechanical, which basically just picking them off, you drop them in the soapy water or squeeze them if you wanted to, and that works very well. And then a bit of, really our last control is chemical, and you may at some point in time have to spray. But that's really the last resort there. Yes, ma'am.
Mark, I had a problem last year with Japanese beetles all over my beans, and they would come in. I could get rid of them, and then that afternoon they'd be up there again. Tons of them. How do you get rid of those things?
Liquid 7 works very well with Japanese beetles. But that's the problem, that you know, there's 10 million of them out there. And of course, the population changes from year to year, but some years they can be really bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
I treated the soil, and it's 10 years ago, and it's fine. I haven't had any.
Good. You're lucky.
Yeah, Southern in Graham, Southern, I asked them about it, and they have whatever it is.
It's like a milky spore.
Southern States. Yeah.
Yeah. So sometimes that works, but not every time. Okay. All right. So we'll look at. So if you see this creature out there on your beans, what are you going to do? What are you going to spray him with?
Nothing.
Right. Excellent. So that's a baby lady beetle. So that's a good insect. But you know, some people would see that critter out there and you get the liquid 7 or whatever to spray it with. So you need to know what this is. So that's a good bug, and you would not want to kill him. What kind of disease is this? That's right, it's a blossom end rot. So this is a calcium deficiency. So this is not a disease, but people would tend to think that's a disease and want to spray something. It's just a calcium deficiency. So either it's a lack of calcium in the soil or inadequate soil moisture where the plant can't take the calcium up. So there's no reason to do anything there. And you can have this even if you have sufficient calcium, and even if you water like you're supposed to, you can still get blossom end rot. That's just going to happen. Okay, so part of the problem is you go to the big box stores and they have 10,000 different products out there, and it's very confusing to determine what you need and what you don't need. I do have a garden pesticide list here, and You know, it's quite confusing to try to figure out what you need in the garden. And you can look at these things and you can see a bifenthrin product here. You can use it on cucumbers and squash and tomatoes, but you can't use it on beans and peppers. So there's no one product that you can use across the board for everything in the garden. Everything has a different label on it. You start looking at some of these malathions. There's some malathions that can be used on everything, some malathions that can't be. I had no idea until I started doing the research. I thought malathion was malathion. Nope. The label's the law, and whatever the label says is what you have to do. And I've had people who have not paid attention to the label and sprayed something on their garden that wasn't labeled, and when they called the company said, destroy your garden. You cannot harvest anything out of that because you're off the label. And that does happen. Okay, so you need to read the label very, very carefully. You can get into trouble. Yes?
Which of these would be considered safe for an organic garden? I think BT.
The BT is, and the
the garden insecticide also?
Right.
And Ceramide?
Yep, yep. Spinosad, the pyrethrins, Pyganic. Right. Absolutely. So what you also find is something like this insecticidal soap, which is a great product here, and this is a concentrated thing. So it's about a dollar an ounce. It's 47% soap. You also can buy it as a ready-to-use kind of thing, and when you do it that way, it's $34 an ounce. It's only 1% active ingredient. It's all water. Same thing for Liquid 7, concentrate there, it's about $3 an ounce. You buy the ready-to-use, it's less than 1% active ingredient, so you're buying a lot of water. So what I'm telling you is don't buy ready-to-use products. You can buy, you know, a little pump-up sprayer like this for less than 10 bucks if you only have a few plants. Buy the concentrate. We have the county hazardous household waste pickup next Saturday, 14th. The majority of the stuff that we get are ready to use pesticides. Where people have bought one of these things, used it up, or left a little bit in it, and they throw the container away. So we have barrels and barrels of this stuff. If you buy a concentrate and take 5 minutes and a teaspoon to mix it up, there would not be all of this waste that we have to dispose of. Plus, you'd be saving a bunch of money too by not using ready-to-use products. Okay, all right. We can look at a few.
Roundup. Everybody uses it everywhere. I've heard that that's really not good to use. They finally figured it out. Have you heard anything about it?
Well, actually, that's still debatable. So there's studies that say it's not harmful. What I can tell you is that it does not have any soil activity. So there's some herbicides, 2,4-D, dicamba, has some soil activity. Right. So you can't plant seed after you spray. Glyphosate is not like that. And the studies I've seen show that it's not harmful. Of course, any of this stuff is, you need to be careful. So, you know, if you're going to use it, wear gloves, wear boots, wear the PPE that it recommends. You don't know.
I've just been telling people not to use it.
Yeah. There are circumstances where.
It's justified.
Yeah, there are circumstances where it's okay. Yes, sir.
Question on your settle dress directly there. How long will the bottle of that last? You don't use maybe an ounce of it a year. Would it be good for 2 or 3 years?
Yes, sir. So if you keep it in the garage where it won't freeze or get too hot, it's probably good for 2 or 3 years. And what I will tell you real quick about the dust is I don't recommend 7 dust. Now, what they have found is that when you put that on the plants, bees can pick that dust up and carry it back to the hive, and that causes a problem. So the Liquid 7 is better because once it dries on the plant, on the flowers, they can't pick up the dried Liquid 7. But the 7 dust, they found, is starting to be a problem with the bees picking it up with the pollen.
Okay.
So I wouldn't do that. Okay, we look at a few insects here. So we've got aphids there. So here's a list of things that you could use for aphid control. And where we have these days here, so that is what's called the pre-harvest interval. So that's a time from the time you spray until the time that you can harvest. So if you look at the pyrethrin, the neem, the soaps, that's 0 day. That means you could spray that this morning, you could pick your beans this afternoon, fine, no problem. But to get down here to Malathon, that could be 1 to 7 days. So depending on what it is, so, and I can't tell off the top of my head, this list may tell me, let's see here. Could be 7 days on beans and maybe 1 day on tomatoes. It's going to depend on what brand you buy. But you have to look at the label to see. But so you got to be careful. So if you've got aphids on cucumbers and it's a 7 day pre-harvest interval, that's a problem. You can't wait 7 days to pick your cucumbers or they'll be too big. All kinds of beetles that you have out there in the garden, some of them are, can be a pest problem, and you know which one is which. But again, you go through the list here, so if you don't have many, you can pick them off, and that works fine. Drop them in some soapy water, that'll take care of them. Soap pyrethrins are fine. As you get into the carbaryl, that's 7, 3 days there. So, you know, depending on what they're on, if they're on cucumbers, 3 days maybe too long on the cucumbers. Yes, ma'am.
We've got a question.
Sure.
On this garden pesticide list, what does the A stand for?
That's the number of applications.
Right.
The number of applications.
Oh, okay.
So what's going to vary is how many applications that you can apply according to the label during the season. So some of these things that only have 4 applications, and if you're spraying twice a week, that doesn't get you very far through the season. So, but again, that's on the label, so you're supposed to follow the label. So if it only says you can apply this one product twice, you can apply it twice, and you're done with that. You've got to get something else. So I mean, this whole thing is way more complicated than what you would think. You just can't just go and buy one thing and spray the garden and be done. You've really got to do a lot of research to figure out what can you spray, what's the label on, how many applications can you do, and what's the pre-harvest interval, to make sure that you don't mess up and spray something that's going to either destroy the garden or prevents you from picking when you need to. Okay. Lots of different cabbage loopers, cabbage worms out there in the garden. When you see a little white moth, brown moth, and you see the moth out there, you know that the cabbage loopers, the worms are not far behind. You can use some row cover. I got some row cover here. So while this is good for frost protection, it's also very good to protect your plants. So, you know, a lot of our leafy stuff, I'm not too concerned about pollination, but you could cover this up, cover over your collards and cabbage and whatever, and that keeps those moths from getting on there laying the eggs that would bring on the caterpillars. Again, you can pick them off and squeeze them, and that's satisfying. But the BT products work really, really well. So that's a Bacillus thuringiensis-ish kind of thing. So it works great. Dipel has a dust. I wouldn't use the dust. The liquid Dipel or liquid thuricide is going to be better, get better coverage. But what happens is as the caterpillars eat the leaf, they eat this bacteria, and it gets in their gut and kills them. It takes a couple of days, but it's very effective. And again, this is very safe. So you can spray your collards this morning, pick them this afternoon, and you're good. And it works really good. Then you keep going down to things that are going to have 1 day or 3 day pre-harvest, and we'll just have to look at that label. But the BT products work great for all these caterpillars. Squash vine borer, there's the adult. Squash vine borer is the only insect that I recommend doing a preventative spray. Everything else you can spray once you see it. So you get out there in the garden, you're scouting, you're looking around, then you take care of the problem as you see it. When you see this, that's the adult squash vine borer. Next thing's gonna happen is you're gonna have that caterpillar inside the vine, and it's too late. There's nothing you can do about that at that point in time. So when you start seeing the adult moth out there, it's time to start spraying the stems, or you're gonna have a problem. Squash bugs, you can control them, no problem. So different things that you can use there. Pyrethrins, BT has some effectiveness on that. You've got to spray fairly often. Permethrin. So all these things will work, but you just got to be on top of the squash vine borer. Everything else you can kind of be reactive to, but you better be proactive on squash vine borer, or they'll just destroy your plants.
Mark, how do you know the difference in the flowers, the male and female? How do you recognize that?
The female flower is going to have a little enlargement at the base of the flower. So that's like the immature ovary part. I can't explain it, but very well.
It's like the tiny fruit.
Yeah. Okay. Spider mites on beans. Yeah, they're one of those things. You can go from 6 to 600 in about 2 days, so you really got to be out there on top of those. Soap, oils, all these things work very well. You just kind of need to pick the product that matches your production. So, you know, if you're not in harvest, then you could use a bifenthrin product. Once you start to get into harvest time, you probably can't. That 3 day pre harvest interval is probably going to be an issue for you. Stink bugs will do this kind of damage on your tomatoes there. They can be a real problem. And again, the same kind of thing here, which we're just looking at, you know, what's effective, what's the pre-harvest interval, what fits best into your system. And you can pick them off if you're fairly quick. Okay. So we got thrips, which transmit this tomato spotted wilt virus, so you really have to kind of watch out for thrips out there. So really, you just need to be in the garden and looking and seeing what's going on. And that way, this stuff doesn't get ahead of you or you can't handle it. Again, there's more stuff there that can take care of thrips. You just need to make sure you find them when the population is small before they build up too much. Okay. So what's worse than finding a tomato fruit worm in a tomato? Half a fruit worm, yeah. Again, so this is one of those things that you could pick off and squish. It's very satisfying if you wanted to. If you see one like this, that's been parasitized, so those are eggs of a parasitic wasp. So if you see that guy, just leave him, because that worm is going to die very quickly, and then all those eggs will hatch, and you'll have a bunch more parasitic wasps to take care of those worms. So you leave that one alone, and the rest of them you can control. So hand picking them off again, soaks pyrethrins. You know, permethrin, so on tomatoes, that's 7 days. Once you get in production, you can't really use that, because you don't know that you can go 7 days between picking tomatoes, unless you pick everything off at one time and then wait. So probably that's not something you could use on there. White flies, you'll have white flies on tomatoes. They can be a real problem again. So you just have to look at, you know, what works, what's effective, and this is one of the things, especially you want to make sure that you get this before the population gets out of hand. So you see a few white flies, you better get on them, because they'll have a big population increase really, really quick. Early blights are probably the most common tomato disease that you'll see. If you're watering the plants overhead, sprinkler or hand watering, getting the leaves wet, that's going to make this worse. So you really got to be very careful about how you water. You're still going to have it, even if you have drip irrigation, but you just have to be careful about how you water, because that will make it worse. Powdery mildew, a disease we'll have in the garden very often. Rust, another disease we'll have on beans. Rotation, we talked about the crop rotation there. Tilling it, resistant varieties is going to help. Then you can use copper, sulfur, daconil, mancozeb is probably one of our best fungicides for early blight, but it's got a 5 day pre-harvest interval. So you could use daconil on tomatoes early season for early blight. Works pretty well, But as you get into the season, you start picking tomatoes, you can't use it because 5-day pre-harvest interval will give you a real problem on tomatoes. Let's see.
I've got a question.
Yes.
What does tillage mean?
So just turning the soil.
That helps the disease.
Yep. Because what happens is you'll have plant litter.
Yes.
So disease leaves that fall on the ground, and you turn those into the soil to bury the spores. Okay, that's all I got. Do we have questions? Yes, ma'am.
Soil test. Is there a particular soil test that you recommend, brand name or anything?
What we do is we recommend the one that's done by the Department of Agriculture. So hold your box up real quick. So we've got the boxes here. And this is done in Raleigh at the NCDA office. A soil test is free from April 1st through Thanksgiving. And so you've got two choices. You can get the sample boxes. You can mail them down there if you're in a hurry. If you're not in a hurry, you can bring the samples to us, and we'll send them or take them when we go to Raleigh. But that could be once a month or something like that. But soil test is free, as opposed to you can buy soil test kits. They're not very accurate. We've tried some here, and we just didn't get good results. And so while you have to wait a little bit on this, it's very accurate, and it's free.
How long does it take to get good results now? Is it too late?
We're probably 30 days. I haven't looked at the thing. But what I would say is if you know what you've been doing, I can give you a recommendation to start, and then take your sample, send it in, and then when a report comes back, that if you need, if I said 20 pounds of lime, you need 30, you add a little bit of extra. Yes, ma'am.
So this, where we're planting our garden, has never been a garden before.
Okay.
Is there any sort of general recommendation that, you know, you would say it always needs lime, or it always needs?
Yeah, if it hasn't been limed, it's going to have lime. 90% of the time. There are rare occasions where you'll find some soil where the pH is right, but that's highly unusual. So I'd say on new ground like that, I would do 30 or 40 pounds of lime per 1,000 square feet, and then something like probably 20 pounds of a 10, 20, 20 to get your... So like 30 to 40 pounds of lime per 1,000 square feet, and then probably 20 pounds of a 10, 20, 20. So what the 10-20-20 does is has a higher phosphorus potassium concentration in there, and till that in. And that sort of gives you a sort of a baseline, and then you can get your report back and see if you need to
tweak it a little.
Right. But for new ground that hadn't been worked, that
would it's never been worked.
Right, that's a good start. Yes, ma'am.
But take the soil sample before you amend the soil.
Right. Yeah, get sample first before you put the lime fertilizer down. Right.
If fencing is not an option, what's the best deer deterrent?
There are some repellents that are, that have the rotten eggs and hot pepper stuff in that. It works okay, but you have to reapply it fairly constantly because the rain washes it off. So fence is the best. If you can't do that, then repellents are second best. And they're yes, sir.
I'm composting some leaves, and I chop them up real fine.
Yep.
And I add a little bit of table scraps like vegetables,
sure,
and eggshells and stuff.
Yep.
And I add some lime to that. How long do you think before I can put it in the garden?
2 or 3 months.
Yeah.
So it depends, and it doesn't have to be back to dirt. So you know this. This is here, probably 6 months old, and you can still see leaf pieces. This is fine. You go ahead and till this in, and it's no problem. It'll be fine. So it depends on the time of year, but a couple months.
Yeah.
Hey. Yes, ma'am.
I plant vegetables between my flowers.
Okay.
And a lot of the yard is azaleas, and so about using the lime, do I really have to be careful to keep it away from the azaleas, right?
Yep.
Like, they should be in a separate bed.
Right.
Right. Okay. Right.
So they want to be pH probably 5, and the vegetable probably pH of 6.
But I don't have to do anything with azaleas, just okay with the soil as it is.
Probably. Thanks. Other questions? Yes, sir.
I love the question on raised garden if you have smaller places. And you said, well, good, if you try something that don't last a year, that's endless. I had gone up to the Southern Tire and bought some old tire.
Okay.
And I cut one side of it out.
Okay.
And to put that and filled it up with your top soil, whatever you need to put in. And some of them are deeper. Some are 6 inches. I've got one, I think, 12 or 14 inches.
Okay.
And it's about 3 foot, 28 to 30 inches, whatever. And you can plant several different plants in
there. Oh, yeah.
And it also contains the dirt to keep it in there.
Right.
The only problem you would have on that is like you need to water it more often or it will dry out.
Right.
So I'm going to give that a shot.
Yeah, yeah. I think that'll work. So anytime you have a question going forward, feel free to call or email either me or Chris, and we're always glad to help. Yes, ma'am.
How can you get rid of the squirrels?
I had no answer for squirrels.
High velocity lead poisoning.
I could not get them out. I got mixing rat holes and just kind of put the little pellets around.
Oh.
Where I have about 25, I think I've got 8 or 10 now. So it will work. Squirrel is a cure.
Oh, yeah.
They will check around. And they will sure do. $1.65 for about 30 pellets.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I noticed that when you showed your garden picture, okay, you had some black.
Yes.
Okay, what was that?
So that was not plastic, but it's this woven, it's like a silk fencing material that I put down and planted through that. But I only did that 1 year. I didn't really like it. So,
okay.
So commercially, they use black plastic to drip underneath it and plant the plants.
Is that what they use on the strawberries?
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Okay. I did it one time to hold the weeds down, but I just didn't like it because I couldn't get to the soil, mm-hmm. and I like to sort of root around in there. And so I did away with that. I just used leaves as mulch, which works just as well, I thought, as a fabric, and then I could just turn those leaves in as organic matter at the end of the season.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
What about that red plastic they sell to put under your tomatoes? Do you think that has any?
A little bit.
Yeah?
A little bit,
well,
maybe.
Say something about the...
Something about the light reflecting. I read something about that. I don't know if it's a huge difference,
but
it may help
that.
A little bit. What's that?
You hadn't tried
no,
it.
No. Yes.
Carrots.
Carrots.
They need a sandy soil? Or a
yes. Leaf? Yeah, so heavy clay soil, the carrots won't do well because they can't mm-hmm. grow down. Yeah.
Like a place or something?
Well, what I would do is I would use this pine fines and incorporate in the soil that you've got.
Okay.
That would do better. That'll loosen it up and make it deeper where the carrots can grow down. And I also would look for a carrot variety that's shorter. So they have all different lengths of carrots. I try and get one that's like a 6 or 8 inch carrot. You probably can do that. The ones that are 10 or 12, you're going to hit hard ground and they're going to be unhappy. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
What kind of mulch did you have on that beautiful garden that you
grew up? That actually had some pine bark mulch on it, but it didn't have enough leaves. I don't have any leaves in my yard, and it's hard to find leaves, so I had to actually buy mulch for that. I'd rather have leaves. Leaves are the best. But if you don't have leaves. Yep. I use pine bark mulch.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I got a truck delivered that black composting stuff from Saxophone.
Yeah.
From what are your comments about that? And is that organic or how do you consider that? Or
where did it come from?
The Scotsman Miller Saxophone, one of the landfill.
It's not organic.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It wasn't from Evan Shrubber. It was delivered.
Yeah. I know the landfill has a composted yard waste.
I think it is leaf something. It's black, really black and very, very soft.
It depends on where it comes from. So there's their city of Burlington has one they call Comp Your Grow, but I think it has some sewage sludge in it. So you gotta need to know what the source is. I'm not really sure. You do have to be careful. And so there's a commercial compost, a Brooks compost, so it's very good compost, but it has a high phosphorus content and a high lime equivalency. And so if you use that over a number of years, it'll push your pH and phosphorus up real high, so you can't use that year after year. So you just got to know the source of where it's coming from.
I don't know. They have this tag with it saying how they processed it. And
okay.
How they had to use it and all that kind of stuff. So I felt
yeah.
But it things really grown.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Are slugs a problem around here?
Slugs?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yes.
I had a bad problem with them in Nashville. Okay.
They're here too. Darn. Yep.
And snails. Yep. I have snails. All these snails, baby snails, they're everywhere.
They got those. Yep.
Other than squish them.
A little cup of beer. I seem to like that very much. Yeah. Yeah, just cheap beer.
I'm not going to get them the good.
No. Don't buy Red Oak if you want to get some PBR or something cheap. They like that fine. Well, I'm sure they do. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Mine is John. I want to know what I can plant on my terrace.
Okay.
Like a tomato bush.
Yeah. Do you have sun?
Not a whole lot. Maybe 4 hours, but it's very bright. I'm on the fourth floor.
Okay. I try it and see.
Yeah.
I try it and see. I mean, that's the thing. You just try it and see.
What kind of a tomato should I buy?
So they and I couldn't tell you the variety, but they do have some tomatoes that grow smaller. Like it's like a patio tomato. And that would stay small and would work in a pot. So I'd give it a whirl and see. Why not? Sure. Okay. Other questions? We're good. Okay.
Rabbits, is it the short stem something?
Probably a foot and a half, 2 foot. Unless they dig under it. Okay. Thank you very much.